Well, good morning, beloveds. I am glad to be back with you in person and with those of you online after a time away of visiting my son and seeing the eclipse of the other kind of sun. It was truly, truly incredible and inspiring. And as a friend of mine said before I saw it, you cannot oversell this. It was truly, truly a remarkable occurrence of God's creation. As you can see, there are quite a few announcements in your bulletin, opportunities for fellowship and service and faith formation. And I hope that each one of you can find a place to plug in and to grow in relationship with God and with one another through these activities. For starters, everyone is welcome to stay after worship today to help assemble 300 hygiene kits for Church World Services, and you can see more about the needs for that in your bulletin. What other invitations or announcements do you have to share with the body this morning?
Phyllis Kepner, just a reminder to sign up for April 27th for our church meal together. And Chris Ivy is a character juggler who will be offering the entertainment that night. His theme is entitled Blessings. It's scripture-based. This is for people of all ages. There is a sign-up sheet out in the hallway across from the mailboxes. Please sign up so we have a count for the meal that night. Thank you very much.
As we make a switch from getting here to being here, consider this thought. Prayer is the glue that holds all of the pieces of life together. We are invited to pray without ceasing, but the invitation isn't to bring God to us. It's to be with God here and now, for the party has begun.
Well, good morning. Beautiful way to start the day here in our worship service, and then go out into the sunny, beautiful day that we have ahead. Would you please rise in body or in spirit and join in the responsive call to worship found in your bulletin or on the screen? You will read the bold text and then remain standing in this posture of praise for the hymn, and invocation. Our call to worship this morning is an adaptation of Psalm 8. We will begin by reading together. O Lord, our sovereign, how majesty is your name in all the earth. You have set your glory above the heavens. When we look at your heavens, the work of your fingers, the moon and the stars that you have established, what are human beings that you are mindful of us? Yet you have made us a little lower than God and crowned us with glory and honor. You have given us dominion over the works of your hands. You have put all things under our feet, all sheep and oxen, and also the beasts of the field, birds of the air, and fish of the sea. O Lord, our sovereign, how majesty is your name in all the earth. Please join in singing our first hymn, number 112, O Lord, our Lord, how majestic. Let us pray. Listening God, gather us in and pour out on us all that we need, satisfying those who persist in prayer. Make us bold in asking, thankful in receiving, tireless in seeking, and joyful in finding, that we may always proclaim your coming kingdom and do your will on earth as it is in heaven. You may be seated. This morning's text is very familiar, and yet just enough difference to catch our attention afresh. Hear these words from the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 6, verses 9 through 13, and I'll be reading from the New International Version of the Bible. This then is how you should pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name, your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we have forgiven our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from the evil one. May God bless the reading of these words.
Forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever.
As we did during Lent, we will conclude our congregational prayer by singing together, although it won't necessarily be the same song each week. Today, the song is, O Lord, Hear My Prayer. And you can find it in your hymnal now if you choose. It's 348, or you can simply sing along to the words on the screen.
Our Father, who art in heaven,
remind us this day that you are not only creation's architect, but you are the babe who cried for food, the teenager who knew loneliness, and the adult who felt the rejection of loved ones.
Hallowed be thy name.
Yours is the name spun by the stars. Yours is the name whispered by the dying. Yours is the name written on our hearts.
Thy kingdom come.
Make it a kingdom of peace, not prejudice. Make it a kingdom of sharing, not grasping. Make it a kingdom of hope, not hurting.
Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven.
With your word more than print on a page, and your justice more than a wish in our hearts, and your will our deepest desire.
Give us this day our daily bread.
Let us taste it in the kisses of loved ones. Let it fill us in the empty moments of our lives. Let it slip out of our hands to mend the brokenness of our world.
And forgive us our debts as we forgive others.
So that those who have hurt us find a welcome in our hearts, even as we have found our home in yours.
And lead us not into temptation.
Turn our hearts from the seductions of our world and the simple pleasures that turn us from you. Keep us from thinking that we are so important that we ignore those around us. Help us to always bring others to you in prayer before we bring even ourselves, as we do in these moments, as we remember those experiencing pain, waiting for your relief, those desiring healing and wholeness, seeking restoration in body and spirit, those grieving loss that sneaks up in unexpected places and times, those suffering in the wake of natural disasters, for whom our hygiene kits assembled after church today will bring some relief, for those seeking a renewal of broken relationships, and those yearning for freedom of addictions of many kinds, and those desiring a closer walk with you.
But deliver us from evil.
Not just great evils of war and hunger, but from ingratitude, self-love, pride, all those little evils that do such great harm.
For thine is the kingdom,
our true heart's longing,
and the power,
which you set aside to serve us in weakness,
and the glory,
which we would mirror in our lives, our bodies, our minds, our souls, this day and every day.
Forever and ever.
Amen.
We all come to worship with different needs and leave with different answers. Spending this time as community, sharing sacred story, singing holy song, joining hearts in prayer and translating this time into our daily lives, our core spiritual practices for many of us. Sharing financial gifts is also a spiritual practice. You are invited to support the work of this church and the ministries beyond these walls by giving freely what you can. Will the ushers please come forward to collect our tithes and gifts of love? Let us pray. Generous God, thank you for our church, for the way we are called to be the church to our neighbors, near and far. Help us continue to share with those in need and with each other through these gifts, freely and prayerfully given. Amen. You may be seated.
So this morning, we are beginning a three-part series on prayer, thanks to the request from one of you who asked, "Teach us to pray." I chose to speak to this topic for 3 weeks, but actually, I could have preached the entire spring and maybe the entire year on prayer. Not only are there hundreds of prayers recorded in Scripture, there are thousands of books written on this topic. In preparation for this series, I've been working with just three of them. The first is a classic written by Richard Foster, who is perhaps best known for his work, The Celebration of Discipline. Prayer is included as one of the spiritual disciplines in this very well-known book, and it is so important that he then wrote a second book called Simply Prayer. For a more introspective look at prayer, I'm using the book Psalms, Prayers for the Heart by Eugene Peterson, and you'll recognize his name as the author of the Message paraphrase of Scripture. And for a more academic approach, I'm using actually one of my seminary books called Let the Whole Church Say Amen, A Guide for Those Who Pray in Public. See? Thousands and thousands of pages have been written on the topic of prayer. Now, today's sermon, I'm hoping, will be a little interactive. I've missed talking to you, so I hope that you will talk back to me and don't be shy. So let me begin by asking you this morning, why do we pray? Why do you pray? Shout.
Connection with God.
Connection with God.
Express gratitude.
Express gratitude. Oh, Mary?
I need it.
Uh-huh. You guys are going to put me on the spot if you raise your hands and hope I'm going to come up with names. Any others? Well, those are great answers. All of them are good reasons. I would like to suggest three possible answers to think about this morning and in your week as you have your own prayer time. We pray because we want to establish and deepen our relationship with our Creator, because we love someone so much that prayer on their behalf is how we express it, and because Jesus said so. I'd like to start with that last reason first, because Jesus said so. When brethren gathered for the first time back 300 plus years ago in Germany, they pored over the scriptures to see what Jesus actually wanted them to do. And how many commands of Jesus do you think that they found? Thoughts? Throw out a number.
35.
Would you guess higher or lower? Ooh, okay. Well, can you name a few?
Do this in remembrance of me.
Yes. Yes, do this in remembrance of me. Love one another. Here are some others. Repent. That's actually a big one. Do as I have done to you, following the act of foot washing. And, you know, come on, guys, pray. Like, that was an obvious one. One reference I found said that there were 684 commands of Christ in the New Testament. Those are some Old Testament numbers, don't you think? And then some scholars narrowed and grouped them into a list of about 50 categories. And then they grouped that list further into 7 major commandments of Jesus, which seems like a nice biblical number of completion to me. And those 7 are love God and neighbors, give, repent, be baptized, make disciples, share communion, and pray. We pray because Jesus told us to, commanded it. And after hearing Jesus instruct them to pray, the disciples boldly commanded back to Jesus, "Teach us to pray." I love this. I love this beautiful mutuality. And maybe because it was a command rather than a request or a question, Jesus didn't answer with a question or a parable, as he sometimes does. This time, Jesus flat out answered, and he taught them what we now call the Lord's Prayer. This prayer is recorded in both the Gospels of Luke and Matthew. Luke records Jesus' words as, "When you pray, say," But Matthew's take is a little bit different. Matthew quotes Jesus as saying, pray then in this way. In other words, pray in this manner. Don't simply recite it, mean it. In this month's newsletter and in recent emails, I have encouraged you to get a notebook and to use it as a prayer journal for the rest of this month and beyond if you like the spiritual discipline of this practice. And this week, I want to encourage you to spend some time really looking at the Lord's Prayer in Matthew 6. I want you to try rewriting it in your own words. What is it that Jesus is teaching us through the language of this prayer? I once took a 3-hour workshop on the Lord's Prayer. And I'm guessing you are not prepared for a 3-hour sermon this morning. So let me just give you one brief example of how rich this scripture is, one that many of us have memorized and can recite without even thinking about it. You can take this start and continue thinking about it at home. So let's just simply consider the very first line, "Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name." Our Father. This phrase suggests a closeness that we are invited to have with God. Jesus likely used the word Abba here, which is more or less an equivalent to the word daddy. It is the most personal, most affectionate name a child could use for their parent. Jesus is inviting us to be that familiar with God, but lest we lose our sense of the holy, he immediately follows up with, "Hallowed be thy name." This is also translated as, "Holy be thy name." We are invited to approach God with intimacy, but we are never to lose sight of God's divine character, the eternal one, who seeks a relationship with us, is also the creator of the universe. Can you even wrap your head around that? I encourage you to spend much more time this week with your journal and this prayer. But now I want to talk for a minute about the second reason that I've suggested for prayer. And that is that we pray because we love other people. When friends and loved ones share their burdens with us, when we share our needs and concerns with one another as the body of Christ, why do we offer to pray for one another? We could choose instead to just offer some practical advice. Or we might even have the tools and the resources to meet the needs that are being expressed. But oftentimes, we offer to pray. Why? I love what Richard Foster says about praying for others. If we truly love people, we will desire for them far more than it is within our power to give. And this will lead us to prayer. Intercession is a way of loving one another. When we move from petition to intercession, we are shifting our center of gravity away from our own needs to the needs and concerns of others. Intercessory prayer is a selfless prayer and even self-giving prayer. In the ongoing work of the kingdom of God, nothing is more important than intercessory prayer. End quote. Intercessory prayer, it's big language for praying on behalf of others. And it is so important that God even provides intercession for us, because God wants to remove any obstacles to a loving conversation with us. So let me explain what I mean. We can come up with all kinds of excuses for why we don't want to pray, and a big one is, I'm not good at it, right? I don't speak well. I never know what to say. I mean, this is not even a new or creative excuse, which is not to say that I have not used this occasionally. This excuse is recorded all the way back in Exodus. Remember Moses? God appears to Moses in the burning bush, and he tells him to go to Egypt and intercede. Demand that Pharaoh free the Israelite slaves. And then Moses spends two entire chapters, telling God why this is a bad idea. And God is pretty patient with our hero Moses, until Moses says, I have never been eloquent, neither in the past nor even now. I am slow of speech and slow of tongue. Oh, my Lord, please send someone else. And in the very next verse, it says, then the anger of the Lord was kindled against Moses, but goes right on to say, I will be with your mouth and with his mouth, talking about Moses' brother Aaron, and I will teach you what you should do. God has been promising to do this from practically the beginning of humanity, and God promises this today. Romans 8, 26 and 27 says, likewise, the Spirit helps us in our weakness, for we do not know how to pray as we ought. But that very Spirit intercedes with sighs too deep for words. And God, who searches the heart, knows what is the mind of the Spirit, because the Spirit intercedes for us according to the will of God. Isn't that incredibly reassuring? We can approach God with confidence because God already knows what's in our hearts, and the Spirit aligns our requests with the will of God. And so if God already knows what we need, and God already knows what's in our hearts, then really, what is the point of this prayer stuff? Is it simply because Jesus told us to? Or because we pull it out when we don't know what else to do, when we feel powerless? And this brings me to the third reason for prayer. Because it strengthens our relationship with the one who created us and who loves us enough to dwell among us and within us. Listen to what Eugene Peterson says about prayer. Prayer is language used in relation to God. It gives utterance to what we sense or want or respond to before God. God speaks to us, and our answers are our prayers. The answers are not always articulate. Silence, sighs, groaning, these also constitute responses, but God is always involved, whether in darkness or in light, in faith or despair. And this is hard to get used to because our habit is to talk about God, not to God. End quote. Beloveds, prayer is simply talking to God. We pray with the expectation that God hears us and that God will answer. And one thing I have noted in all of the prayers recorded in Scripture, and there are hundreds of them, is the use of these very active verbs. Did you hear it in the Lord's Prayer? Give us this day. Forgive us our debts. Lead us. The language, it's kind of demanding. It's almost bossy. And when you stop and really think about that, does it make you uncomfortable? Who am I to be telling God what to do? But remember that Jesus instructed his disciples to do it in this way. Why? In the book, Let the Whole Church Say Amen, the author cautions against a false sense of humility that we can sometimes lapse into in an effort to not appear arrogant before God. And I'll give you an example. Oh God, we just want to ask for your blessing. Have you ever prayed something like that? I don't want to trouble you, God, if you could just help me out here. The author says that, first of all, there is no biblical precedence for this kind of prayer. It is not found anywhere in Scripture. And further, it almost implies that prayer is no big deal. The author goes on to say it almost indicates that maybe God is not such a big deal either. Remember, I told you, prayer was included in the book on spiritual disciplines. And since God already knows what we need and what's in our hearts, part of the purpose of prayer is disciplining us on how we talk to and think about God. And as our relationship grows, God is no longer a stranger whom we must approach timidly. We have the liberty as children of God to say boldly what is on our hearts, trusting that God will sift the wheat from the chaff of our prayers, because God said he would. That is incredible. Sometimes our prayers take on what's called an absent deity syndrome. These kind of prayers sound like we're not even sure that God is in our midst or concerned at all about our welfare. And here is an example. We ask you, God, to be with so-and-so as they face difficult times. What is the purpose of to be with? Does that imply that God is not usually with that person? So many times in Scripture, God and Jesus promise to be with us. Do not be afraid. I am with you, and I will be with you till the end of the age. Nowhere in Scripture does it say, I will be with you, but only if you ask. Better language would be, comfort so-and-so. Reveal yourself to so-and-so, because isn't that exactly what we're asking? That is not bossy language, friends. That is language that expresses in faith that God hears and that God will move. It is trust. Our God is worthy of our praise, worthy of our trust, worthy of our prayers. We read together as our call to worship, and we sang together the glorious prayer in Psalm 8. O Lord, our sovereign, how majestic is your name in all the earth. When I look at your heavens, at the work of your fingers, the moon and the stars that you have established, and eclipses too, what are human beings that you are mindful of us? Is this the beginning of an absent deity prayer? God is wonderful, and we are worms not worth considering or having a relationship with. No. The psalm continues, you have made them, us, a little lower than God, and crowned them, us, with glory and honor. One commentary for this verse explained, humanity's place in creation is an extraordinary gift from God. Human beings made by God in God's image and crowned with glory and honor are accorded royal status. This is not an absent or a distant God. This is a God in our midst, fully engaged in our destiny, ever concerned for our welfare, and prayer is how we encounter and engage with that God. I mentioned earlier that I want to encourage you to grab a notebook and spend some time looking at the Lord's Prayer this week. Try writing it in your own words to uniquely reflect your relationship with God. And to help you remember, I've included it on the back of your bulletin under the heading Prompts for Your Prayer Journal. And friends, if you are worshiping with us online, you can find the bulletin on our website and journal with us. Now you'll see on the back of your bulletin that I am also encouraging you to try writing down your prayer requests. And there are two reasons for that. The first is that it allows you to look back later and see how God answered your prayers. And that is an incredibly valuable exercise. But this practice of writing your prayers also helps you look at the very words that you are praying. This is not to make them perfect in the eyes of God. We have an intercessor, the Holy Spirit, who does that for us. Instead, it allows you to be intentional in your language. What do the words that you use tell you about your relationship with God? In the end, that's really what prayer is all about, a love relationship with God. In the introduction to his book, Prayer, Foster says, the truth of the matter is, we all come to prayer with a tangled mess of motives, altruistic and selfish, merciful and hateful, loving and bitter. Frankly, this side of eternity, we will never unravel the good from the bad, the pure from the impure. But what I have come to see, Foster says, is that God is big enough to receive us with all of our mixture. We do not have to be bright or pure or filled with faith or anything. That is what grace means. And not only are we saved by grace, we live by it as well, and we pray by it. And the whole church said, Amen.
Thank you.
You are all invited to stay after in the fellowship hall and help assemble the hygiene kits. And go now and know that God goes with you. Let God lead you each day into the quiet place of your heart where God will speak to you. Know that the Creator blesses and watches over you, listens to you in gentle understanding, and is with you always, wherever you may go, and however you may feel. So go in peace. Amen.